The shaping of metals into tools and useful objects has since prehistoric times fueled civilization and socio-economic development of mankind. It was therefore logical that the Bronze Age and the Iron Age followed the Stone Age. In fact, the Industrial Revolution that swept Western Europe with the invention of the steam engine and the wheel would have had minimal effect if iron smelting and the subsequent production of steel had not preceded it. Forging or blacksmithing is one of the principal methods of shaping metals and has a long history in Ghana. In the Akan-speaking areas of southern Ghana, there is a song that praises the village blacksmith who wakes people up in the morning at night, but produces implements and tools for the farmer, the fisherman, and the hunter. After colonization of the Gold Coast, the construction of railways to link the mining and timber producing areas necessitated the importation of machinery and equipment. The anvil arrived to augment the equipment of the Gold Coast blacksmith, who already had a smart hat fanned by a bell. Due to wear and tear of imported machinery and equipment, scrap steel became available and the industry boomed. The anvil, bellow and mud hack are still in use today, but as in other artisanal trades, development in terms of equipment use has taken place. What has not substantially changed is the fact that the trade has a strong and undying family tradition. The first generation of great-grandfather blacksmith hands over knowledge and practice of the craft to grandfather, who in turn passes them on to a father, who similarly leaves them with a son. August Icon is the head of the Icon family at Winneba. He is 97 years old and tells the folklore associated with the craft.
Now, woman, is a junior or yeah, then for an old day.
I'm kind of a woman. What's she? An animal. What she's done, I think. What is it? And I didn't chat over. What is it? It's been in Yemen. She, what is she?
I am with you.
When Jay, Obey Musham, Obey Musham, when you call it Jay, all that is a woman and I will ya, why I show on a no,
The last born, I mean, to the old man, who is the sole proprietor of a small industry. I'm 43 years. You know, we were all born into the trade, and I learned the trade from him. He taught me. He took us around to the trade, and the younger ones were also on the rest. We all trained them, gave them the skills, how best they can also come up into that trade. And up to now, the young ones, even the girls, are all learning. And it has been a family trip. And we are happy our great-grandfathers and grandparents, fathers, were able to, you know, come by this trip that has been able to establish.
The knowledge and practice have survived this way, but the craft faces the danger of dying out because of the reluctance of the youth to learn the trade.
We were in school, we displayed all that.
This video has been produced as part of the collaborative effort by the Center for School and Community Science and Technology Studies, SACOST, of the University College of Education, Winneba, and Gratis Foundation to promote science and technology in Ghana.
SACOST is a Pan-African Research and Materials Development Center for the promotion of community science and school science integration. It was set up by the African Forum for Children's Literacy in Science and Technology with the support of the Norwegian International Development Agency. And they chose Winneba to be the center. The vision of the center is to promote interdisciplinary research and development of materials related to science and technology in community and its link with school science and technology. The mission of the center is to be a center of excellence to cultivate or foster endogenous development of science and technology in Africa and in Ghana also. Well, SACOST has been trying to develop multimedia materials for use in schools, and it does this by bringing in industrialists and people who can contribute towards this. This book, for example, called the Science in Action, a resource book for science teachers, was developed by SACOST with industrialists. We also have developed, you know, a report we call the Innovations in Science and Mathematics and Technology Education. And this one also involved industrialists and other people from outside the country who looked at our science education to see how we can bring in indigenous science activities, as well as even the modern science activities taking place in the industries, modern industries, into the classroom. And we've developed a CD ROM on this also, which we have distributed to quite a number of people inside and outside this country.
The understanding of the science or methodological principles of blacksmithing will arouse interest in both teachers and students, who can in turn assist community blacksmiths to improve upon quality. To start a small blacksmithing workshop, one would need an anvil, a hearth, a hammer and tongs. Other specialized tools which can be made by the blacksmith with the basic complement mentioned include fuller, swage, hardy, flatter and punch. Anvil. The anvil is the workbench of the blacksmith. Its toughness enables the blacksmith to hammer the workpiece to the desired shape.
Anvils play a very major role in forging or blacksmithing. If you look at this, it has various shapes. This side is for punching round holes in metals, hot metals. This is for punching square holes in metals. This side is for making cones and circular eyes when we roll a metal into a circle, we call it an eye, and this is for making that and also to form funnels. Then this side is a similar part, but that makes square corners of an eye, or it is used for folding square holes. Then the tab here is for cutting. Now normally people cut on the face of the anvil, and that spoils the face, so that when you forge something flat, the surface is dented. Now this has been provided for cutting. So we cut here, we forge, we punch square holes, we punch round holes, we make square eyes, we make round eyes and funnels at this portion. That is why the anvil has various shapes. Now when you look at the other side of the anvil here, you see another tap like this at the top here. It is also for cutting.
An improvised anvil can be made from a railway track.
We use this one to fabricate one of improvised anvil due to cost of this anvil. We bring this one. We cut this one into shapes and then weld them with stainless steel. Bring this one back. We cut them according to the shape of the anvil itself. Then you take half of the other downs of weld it with the stainless steel electrode for it to be firm.
Hearth. The hearth is the fireplace where metal is heated to hot working temperature. It can be constructed with landquid blocks, mud, burnt bricks, refractory bricks, or metal. The hearth is fanned in a variety of ways. Other types of fans are the hand-operated gear and motorized blowers. The traditional method of fanning the hearth is by means of a bellow. It is made from tanned leather, spring and wood. The air supplied by the bellow is intermittent. Air is sucked in on the upstroke and forced out on the downstroke. The hand-operated gear blower uses a gear arrangement to turn an enclosed fan blade. Coupling the rotation shaft of the blower to a bicycle rim increases the speed of the fan blade. Thus increases the volume of air supply to the fuel. Unlike the bellow, air supply is continuous and operation is less tedious. The motorized blower often purchased from scrap yards is the most efficient. It, however, requires either a single phase or three phase power supply.
You have to check that for the fact that here is a big institution, you need to get a big blower and a three phase motor to enable us light as many as the hearts we require.
Tongs are essential in a blacksmithing shop. They are used in holding work pieces or blanks for forging and other forming operations such as bending. Fullers are used for fast reduction of the thickness of hot metal. Flatters are used in removing dents, thereby giving smooth and even surfaces to forged components, while the angle grinder imparts good finish. Swage, hardy, punch. The swage, hardy, and punch are useful hand tools in the blacksmithing shop.
The power hammer is to replace the manual hammering. And what it's supposed to do is to bring heavy blow on the workpiece, like this.
The power hammer being developed by Gratis will remove the drudgery from manual hammering and increase productivity. Rake and shovel. The rake and shovel are tools used by the blacksmith in managing his fire. Fuel. In the southern and the transitional ecological zone of Ghana, where the palm tree thrives, the fuel used in huts is carbonized palm kernel shell. In northern Ghana, charcoal is used. For both types of fuel, it is important that inclusion of foreign matter is kept to a minimum to ensure efficient combustion and hence the attainment of the desired working temperature.
I'm sieving the fuel to get out the particles. That brings clinkers to the fire. In fact, if you don't remove them, you have a blockage in the fire.
Both types of fuel are able to heat metal to the needed temperature for forging.
There are stages in forging or blacksmithing. The stages differ from one component to another. For example, if you want to forge a hoe, the ordinary hoe that we use in farming, you know, the hoe is first made flat, then a small curvature is given to it. So first, you heat the metal in the forge. When it becomes red hot, you try to spread it. You use a hammer, which has got a cross face. You hammer the metal, and then you try to spread it. You put in the forge again, and then you bring it back. And then after spreading, you hammer with the flat face of the hammer to get the metal flat. Then when it is flattened, then you use a flatter. That is, hitting it the third time, you use a flatter and hammer it so that the hammer dent on the metal is replenished. Then it is given a small curvature, and that will give you the end of the product you want. Stages differ from one component to another. But in ordinary forging, we say heating, then forging, and then polishing or finishing. That will be the three main stages.
All steels can be forged, but the most common is carbon steel. Depending on the carbon content, such steels can be subjected after forging to heat treatment to obtain varying degrees of hardness and toughness. If the article produced by the blacksmith is reheated and plunged into water or oil, it will be in the hardened condition. It will take on a sharp edge when ground, but will be difficult to machine. If the use for which the part or article is to be put will require it to withstand sudden blows or shock loading, it must be tempered. Compared to castings, forgings have more uniform microscopic structure and their mechanical properties are directional owing to the effect of grain flow during forging. This flat strip of forged metal will have higher strength and toughness across its width than it would do across its length. In producing forged articles, the blacksmith must use blanks that are just sufficient for the job, so that there is little or no waste to be cut off afterwards. The most common scrap steel available to the blacksmith in Ghana are vehicle chassis, half shaft, coil spring, and leaf spring. The vehicle chassis, which is low carbon or mild steel, is not hardenable. The half shaft, which can be used in producing a hammerhead, for example, is of medium carbon content and hardenable. Coil and leaf springs are high carbon and can be hardened. Since the temperature of metal is judged by observation of its color, practice and experience help.
With traditional methods where they use this skin blowers, it is also the same with this manual type. You look at the work, and when the master is around, he watches and sees that the metal is red hot, meaning it is in the plastic stage and it is ready for forging. When he doesn't take care and the metal becomes quite hot, then it is getting into the molten stage. That is the reason why sometimes you take a component from the forge and you find that part of it is molten, meaning that it got over the plastic temperature. That is, it was above the red hot stage.
When steel is heated, it changes color with temperature. It becomes black at temperatures between 560 and 630 degrees Celsius, and then changes to dull red. At temperatures between 800 and 815 degrees Celsius, it becomes sherry red, which is low for forging. At bright red, some forging can be done. However, most forging operations are carried out when the steel is yellow. 1300 to 1400 degrees Celsius is the world in heat. A few white bursting sparks will appear and the metal can be welded. To understand why metals are easily forged at high temperatures, one has to understand why they behave the way they do when under load at room temperature.
We are going to consider metals under load at room temperature and relate to a blacksmith at work. When the blacksmith hammers a metal, the metal is stressed and the metal becomes strained. Now, this is the original length of the rod, LO, and the cross-sectional area, A. When the force is applied, there's this extension and the new length becomes LO plus delta L. If you find the ratio of stress to the strain, we get a constant called Young modulus. This constant measures the resistance of the metal to change in size. If you plot a graph of stress versus strain, we have stress and the strain. Now, we have the straight line from the origin to a point we call proportional point. Within this, the metal will return to its initial form when the stress is removed. Further stress will reach a point we call yield point. We can explain this yield point as a point where the metal will start to yield to the stress. From there, we go to a range. We call it plastic range. Here, the plastic, the metal is deformed permanently and does not return to its initial form. From there, we get to a point we call breaking point, where when there's a further stress, the metal breaks. We call it the stress applied is called rupture stress or ultimate tensile strength. Now, we are going to show the process where the metal becomes longer and stays permanently. That process is called slip process. Now, this is the original length of the metal. Now, we apply the force, and the force here we are saying is being hammered. The force are being applied, and this is the slip process. That there's an increase in length resulting from the slip causing the metal to be plastically deformed. From here, we are going to look at the molecular structure of the atom, what actually takes place within the metal. Now, in an ideal crystal structure, that is, the metal is made up of atoms arranged in a particular pattern we call crystal structure. It's applied to it. There's a movement of plane of atoms. Now we are going to look at it in a real situation. Now in a real situation, crystal structure are not so perfect. The imperfection comes about as a result of formation of the metal or the manufacture. We have three types of imperfections, but what is responsible for plastic deformation is called line defect, also known as dislocation. So this is demonstrating how the elongation takes place. But we are going to look at it, the process leading to this. Now, the process starts from the generation of dislocation by hammering it. Although we have a situation where we have natural ones there, but if you disturb it, you create a dislocation. Now, if the blacksmith continues to hammer it, dislocation moves from one point to another. So it leaves the structure. So the noise we hear means the hammer is being applied and the dislocation is moving. So it is now out and we have got the plastic deformation.
Blacksmithing knowledge and practice were in the past passed on from generation to generation of the same family. This is no longer the only means because of formal education and apprenticeship. Some vocational and technical schools offer blacksmithing courses, but informal sector apprenticeship still remains the main avenue of acquiring the skill.
We offer courses in welding and fabrication, machining, and plumbing. We do blacksmithing here, but we don't offer blacksmithing as a course. Any student who does welding and fabrication also do blacksmithing.
This is the blacksmith hat, and this is the coolant.
The technical apprentice training program of Gratis, which is receiving accreditation, includes both theoretical and practical instruction in blacksmithing for trainees specializing in welding and fabrication.
We realize that one of the dying technologies is blacksmithing in this country. So what we've tried to do as part of our training program is to train master craftsmen and also apprentices to carry on the trade of blacksmithing. Welding and fabrication sessions of the ITTUs incorporate blacksmithing facilities to support manufacturing activities, especially farm tools.
As part of our services, we also provide training in the area of blacksmithing. For the past 10 years, we've offered training program in blacksmithing for blacksmith in the central region. But we've been able to train about 120 of them to upgrade their knowledge in blacksmithing, especially how to produce simple hand tools for their workshop use.
Applied scientists or engineers can solve problems the blacksmith faces. One of the main tasks, therefore, for young students thinking of going into blacksmithing is to consider with equal appraisal and understanding the merits and limitations of both the skill and the engineering or applied science approaches to forging. It is hoped that the young generation will marry the science and the skill and thus sustain the centuries-old Otomfo craft.